It's my pleasure to get the conversation rolling here, but I just want to say a few things. First, let me introduce the panel. So, starting on my far right, I want to introduce to you Chad Orzel. He's an associate professor in the Department of Physics and Astronomy at Union College, that's near Albany, New York. Next to Chad, we have Raymond Laflamme. He is executive director of the Institute for Quantum Computing here at the University of Waterloo, and of course, a world-leading expert in quantum information science. Going closer now, Mike Lazaridis, the Quantum Nano Center bears the name of Mike and his wife Ophelia as a tribute to their remarkable dedication to truly pioneering research, discovery, and innovation. And finally, Tom Brzustowski, who is chair of the board of directors of the Institute for Quantum Computing and a respected expert on Canadian innovation. So I'm going to come over and join the panel. So. So now, as you heard from the introduction, my background is as a science journalist. It's been my pleasure to be sort of an eyewitness to history in all sorts of discoveries in many arenas of science. And one of the standard questions that I like to ask, I think that many science journalists ask, is once you've got a sense that there's a discovery or that there's an innovation that's taken place, is to try to get at why that's happening and what's at the stage for this. And so actually, Ray, I'd like to start with you, given your intimate connection to this place and to the field. Why now? Why is this the time where we would have a quantum nano center, where we would be talking about a place where people will come to do stuff in this area? Why is this the time?
So why now? Why are we studying quantum systems now and trying to control them? I think it's because when we look at the history of technologies, we can find a cycle which starts with curiosity. We're all curious. Why are we curious? I think it's because of Darwin's principle. If we focus curiosity towards understanding physical phenomena of nature, then we can start to control them. And when we control them, we're able to turn them into technologies. And these technologies have impact on society. That it be finding vaccines for polio, that it be new developing vacuum tubes, or if we go back 20,000 years, fire, be able to control it. Steam, industrial revolution, electromagnetism, we see the information revolution we see. And these revolutions have impact on society, and at the same time bring us a new set of tools to start the cycle of curiosity again. And so if I pull back and say, where are we with quantum things? Well, we've seen the first quantum effects about 100 years ago. And now I think we understand pretty well how they work. There are still some conceptual things that we're not totally at ease with, but we understand the mathematics of the theory. We can predict anything beautiful, the Higgs boson. We predicted it, we've seen it. And so we are at the place right now in history where we're starting to control quantum effect. And when we really can control them, then we'll have technologies. So this is what the quantum nano center is about, controlling quantum systems and kind of figuring out what kind of technologies we can take out of this.
So this is interesting because as you mentioned some of the preceding technologies, right, from fire or steam or electromagnetism, you know, speaking of the radio, but you know we think of these things as classical technologies. We've come to manipulate them and to understand them. And see, Chad, I want to ask you about this, but the quantum world is not quite like the other worlds. So when we talk about controlling things in quantum space, how is that different, say, from controlling radio waves or controlling fire or steam?
The thing that's really strange and fascinating about quantum systems is that, to a large degree, they confound our expectations about how the world ought to work. You know, the world that we see around us is sort of a very continuous thing, right? If I'm you know, gesturing randomly, you know, my arm moves continuously across space. It's not here and then here without passing through the intervening space. But in quantum systems, you know, you have only certain discrete allowed states that you're allowed to have. You can have one photon or two photons or three photons, but not 1.5, not 2.25. And the same with energy levels in atoms. An atom can be in one energy state or another, but you'll never find it halfway in between. And that's a very strange sort of situation. And that means that controlling quantum systems is very different than controlling sort of everyday systems, because they respond a little bit differently. And they can also do things that are very unusual, like you can have a quantum system in two states at the same time. Right? The famous thought experiment about this is my dog's favorite experiment in physics, is the Schrodinger's cat, where you imagine putting a cat in a box with a device that has a 50% chance of killing it, and then you ask, what's the state of the cat in the box? And the mathematics of quantum mechanics tell us that before you open the box, the cat is both alive and dead at the same time. And then that seems absurd, and in fact, that's the whole reason Schrodinger suggested that, because he was trying to prove that this was absurd. But in fact, experiments over the last 30 years or so have repeatedly shown that this is in fact true. You can put quantum systems in more than one state at the same time. And that's what forms the basis of quantum computing and what will go on at this institute. So it's very strange and unusual. You're not used to thinking of something being in two places at once. But in the quantum world, that's possible, and that's what opens a lot of technological possibilities.
I think this also gets at some of what you said. You know, there are things about quantum theory that still are disturbing to us. And this is why, I think this is why even imagining the center now can be a little bit disturbing, because I think in the past, it seemed like quantum mechanics or quantum physics was sort of at a safe distance. In one way, it was telling us, it wasn't just looking at the world differently, but it's telling us that we really live in a different world than maybe we thought. But in a sense, it seemed inaccessible. I'm glad you mentioned the Schrodinger's cat experiment. This is coincidentally my cat's least favorite experiment. But the thing that's interesting about that is you start with something like an atom that maybe can decay or not decay, and there's no way, there's nothing inside that atom that tells you whether it's going to pick this moment or not to decay. But then when it does, either it doesn't and the cat is alive, or it does and the cat is dead. And in a sense, both of those realities are existing in some kind of parallel way at the macroscopic level. And it works as a thought experiment to tell you there's something strange. But now we're actually talking about making use of this. We're breaking that barrier between the everyday world, which is concrete and which things are not in two states at a time, to this quantum world. Ray, how can we do that? What is involved in reaching into that world? How can we make that part of our macroscopic reality?
So we need better tools than what we had before. It turns out that quantum effects are extremely fragile. And if they are not very well isolated from their surrounding, then they get washed out in the classical world immersion there. So what we need to do is to have some very good tools in surrounding to have small systems. And in fact, at the beginning, if I go back 50 years ago, 75 years ago, people thought small will be quantum, large will be classical. But we've learned that it's not totally true. It's things well isolated from the surrounding are quantum. The big things are hard to isolate, so that they behave classically. But if we have very good surrounding, very good building with very little vibration like this one here, then suddenly we can isolate larger and larger and larger systems. In fact, today we can have a system which has a micron size, which is about the tenth of a human hair. For most of you, it's pretty small. For me, it's big. It's really big.
Right.
And then we can see them quantum mechanically. They have quantum effects. So we want to keep going. And then suddenly we have a device which will be something to do quantum computing, or a sensor, or something like this. So having the right tools is what is important to do.
So I want to pursue this just a little bit further, because I think this gets at what's so special, not only about this time, but also about this place, because I think what you're telling us, Ray, what I'm hearing is that actually we are living in a quantum world, but it's because of its fragility, the rough and tumble of of the macroscopic world that we live in tends to kind of bury those effects. But if we're very quiet and very careful. So what does that mean in terms of how you outfit a space that can do quantum physics not as theory, but as lab science? What makes this space different?
I mean, the space, like in the building here, has very low vibration. When you go out of this room and you see the one with the orange panels on the other side, this building is totally isolated from where we are right now. So when you look from the outside, it looks kind of neat too, but it's really separated. You go in the basement, there's a little seal between the two places. You take this off, boom, the crack down like that. Building isolated, it doesn't move for more than a micron. The whole building. A frequency between 10 to 100 hertz, so it's really there. It's a big anchor. It has very low electromagnetic radiation, so that the outside doesn't kind of affect our quantum systems. Sorry, Mike, the library doesn't work, but it's on purpose. And also very good temperature control, very good humidity control, so very good insulation. This is what we need.
So speaking of this special place, let's expand that a little bit further, and Mike, I want to ask you about this. And this is kind of the partner question to the why now, which is the why here. So we've just been hearing about this fascinating new area of sciences being opened up in a practical way, this really specially outfitted building that makes it possible. I guess in theory this building could be anywhere on Earth, in quantum theory it could be many places at the same time. But it's the probability wave has collapsed and the building is here in Waterloo. Why here?
It's a very good question. Just to sort of follow on from the previous theme, if you look at the last 100 years, ever since the discovery of both Maxwell's equations and quantum mechanics, we've been basically taking advantage of our insight, but in a way to further our classical belief of reality. And so everything we did was to further our ability to manipulate, better, faster, or cheaper, things that we kind of understood and we took for granted. What's happening now, and this is kind of condense a lot of things in a very short sentence here, but if you look at Moore's law, that is, it was in the film, described quite accurately in the film, we're getting to the point, we've been manufacturing these integrated circuits that really underlie most of the change that's happened in the last 50 years. We've been using a technique called lithography, photolithography. So we've been building these circuits sort of like drawings. But these drawings, the way we thought of them and how they work, we're still thinking of them as classical. And we just keep trying to make them smaller and smaller. What we're doing is we're browbeating these quantum effects as we make these things smaller so that we can build more of the same thing, only smaller, cheaper, and faster. But there is a limit, and the limit's coming up fast. I mean, Gordon Moore, who Moore's Law is named after, actually wrote on his blog that he sees it ending within the next 15 to 20 years. And the reason for that is, as we're getting to the point where our photolithography is getting down to the size of an atom. And there's two things that are happening. One, we can't go any further than that. I mean, we can't even get close to it because we don't have wavelengths that are close enough to that to be able to expose the photolithography. The other thing that's happening is getting more and more expensive to get smaller. That's the opposite of the whole point of Moore's law, which gets cheaper. So we're approaching this, and what we're realizing is that the only way we can scale further than the limit of Moore's law is to harness the quantum, harness quantum computing. Because then what happens is, rather than taking advantage of our understanding of quantum effects to further our classical view of reality, we're now embracing quantum reality. And we've discovered that it computes, and it computes much faster than anything we can ever imagine. And it becomes the fundamental nature of reality. And so we're going from basically taking our understanding over the last 100 years to build information age as we see it, which is really based on a classical understanding, or mindset, to embracing quantum mechanics directly. And that's, I think, the exciting part of the next century.
So, to be kind of the devil's advocate with this, right? You know, I guess with innovation, you have to have this ability to see into the future a little bit. And people who don't would often say, well, why do I need this? You know, why do I need electricity? You know, I was saying in my mother's village, they didn't have electricity in their houses. It required the Soviets to invade and force everyone to have electricity. That's how it finally happened. But someone could say, why do I need this? Why does the industry need to push Moore's law further to keep it going?
Well, I mean, again, that's an interesting question. Think of it this way. Why did we need a computer on our desk, in our homes? I mean, we've all, you know, some of us haven't actually been there to see the whole thing change. Many of us have. Just like your mother's witnessed the whole thing of the last century. You know, some of us here in this panel have witnessed a change where there were no computers at all that were being used to a time when we're carrying them on our person, and that they're always on and connected in this vast array called the internet. You sit back and you say 30, 40 years ago, if someone said, you know, what do you think we need these computers for? They would talk maybe census or scientific calculation, maybe accounting. No one dreamed that it would become the center of our social network today.
And even going back farther than that, there are famous quotes about the invention of the telephone. There's somebody who famously said, this is such an important revolutionary device, someday every city will have one. No one realized that it would be that you'd have one in your pocket at all times.
Someday every city will have a quantum computer. Tom, I'd like to ask you about this as well. I know just before we started, you had started a very enticing conversation about the cycles of innovation. So it seems like we may be sort of looking at the beginning of a new cycle here. Can you tell us why that is, or what makes innovation happen in cycles, and why we're witnessing this now?
I'll try. I think that this deals with some of the questions that have been raised about the perception of the quantum world and why we're moving in that direction. And perhaps the quest here will be the question in front of a panel like this 50 years from now will be, you know, how many quantum computers can you put on the head of a pin? Maybe something like that. But I think the answer to a lot of these things lies in one word: students. And think of it this way. Today, what we've heard from Mike, we've heard from Ray, we've heard from Chad, questions with which we're struggling, trying to understand, trying to interpret, what is this language with which the smallest things in the universe communicate? How can we visualize them in our terms which are grounded in the classical perception? How does that happen? These are difficult things, and these difficulties are shared by professors today who have graduate students. These graduate students, and the undergraduates also who join them from advanced courses and enter the labs, these people will actually solve some of these problems. They will get the answer. But the interesting thing is that their students, in turn, will not know a world in which this is not understood and routine. They've got a span of about three generations, let's say two spans of 25 years. It takes about a half a century. Let me give you an example. An event happened just about 55 years ago, almost precisely 55 years ago, which is one of these things that who would have thought that you would need it? What was the event? The event was that the Soviets launched Sputnik. An artificial satellite started circling the Earth. Why? Who would need such a thing? It all went around and went beep, beep, beep. Great stuff. I remember it.
One day every single will happen.
And yet, think today of all the things that are affected by the fact that there are satellites in space. The bridge among people, which we're talking about, connecting people, communication satellites, TV signals, the internet.
GPS.
Mapping. You know, the satellite that tells you where the parking spots are that are empty. All of these things, we now treat them as entirely routine. I'm sure that the students of today can't think of a world in which space technology and space communications doesn't exist. It'll be the same with one.
Lasers is the other classic example. Is the laser, immediately after its invention, was jokingly referred to as a solution in search of a problem.
Yeah.
So nobody had any idea what you would use that for. Now they're everywhere. Any phone call you make is carried over fiber optic lines by lasers.
Blu-ray you watch.
Yeah, if you watch a movie on Blu-ray or DVD, or if you go, it is just something as mundane as going to the supermarket and buying a gallon of milk, right? You scan it over the laser thing that tells you what the price is. So they're absolutely everywhere now, in ways that it would seem unimaginable to do without them.
They're everywhere in such a way that they're almost invisible because you're just not thinking about them, which is amazing. So if we imagine forward with this kind of technology, and Chad, I actually want to ask you about this too, sort of to go into the black box a little bit. So I'd love to know more about how this quantum world translates into something that we could, that that could become a computer, and what kind of computer that would be. So we've heard already that one way in which the quantum world is different is that things can be in more than one state at a time. Particles might have this property where they can be like this, or they can be like this, or they're sort of at the same time. How does that become useful for the kinds of applications we think of as useful for computing?
So the simplest way to try and explain it is if you build an ordinary computer, you're working with bits that are either 0 or 1. And all that your computer or your cell phone is doing is manipulating lots of things that can be in a state that we call 0 or a state that we call 1. And if you could do math with those numbers, then you can do all sorts of processes. What the quantum computer opens up is the possibility of having something that's in 0 and 1 at the same time. And when you start doing computation with that sort of system, it can be fundamentally different. You can also have situations where the state of a bit over here is both 0 and 1 at the same time and correlated with a state over here that's in 0 and 1 at the same time in a very fundamentally strange way, such that neither of them has a definite state, but as soon as you do something that changes the state of one of them, it will change the state of the other in a corresponding way. And that sort of quantum effect is at the heart of doing quantum information processing and quantum computing. And it turns out there are certain problems where having the ability to do those things allows you to solve those problems much faster than you could with a computer where your bits are either 0 or 1, but definitely one of the two.
And so Ray, I want to ask you: is this for real? Because because it sounds good, and I've read there've been many great books on quantum computing over the years, and there's always that sense that you get towards the end of the book, but we don't know yet if this can actually work. If this will actually be reality, because maybe there are other effects, or maybe there are barriers. The beautiful theory of it is kind of disturbed by some of these macroscopic effects. So how close are we to having quantum computers, or is it, where are we?
So first, it's definitely real.
It's real.
It is the world in which we live, the quantum world. And there's a limit of it which is classical, in which most of them are there. We don't have big quantum computers today, but we have small ones. So Chad mentioned bits, which behaves quantum mechanically. We call them quantum bits, or for short, qubits. So we have small device, a dozen of quantum bits. We can manipulate them. And if I go back 10 years ago, it was people like me, the researchers, the prof, in the lab, who were working hard. Now, we've made the piece of the generation that Tom mentioned. Students, undergrad now comes in for the summer. They go and manipulate and do things 10 times better than what I was doing 10 years ago. So we are starting to control the system. We start to show that it is really happening daily, multiple labs around the world where we can do this. What we need to do is to go from a dozen, 2,000, 3,000 to 100,000. We have a path of going there. Now you're going to ask me exactly what time when this happens. Hard to know. If we go back in 1950, who would have bet that you would have these computers that you carry out in your pocket? So, but who wouldn't be surprised? 25 years, 30 years, maybe 50 years.
So I won't ask you anything, but I will ask you, walk us through a day in the life here. What, for example, when we talk about these qubits, what are they made of? What kinds of systems are promising in terms of what they work on?
So we have about a dozen of ideas about how to build quantum computers. We all fight a little bit of saying mine is better, or yours is better, or we're able to do this. And we have flying qubits that want to go from one place to the other. So what are they made of? If you look at atoms like hydrogen, if you look inside the nucleus, there is what we call a magnetic moment, a small magnet, the magnet point up. It's a zero. To point down, it's a one. But it can also point in this direction. This is zero plus one. This is zero minus one. Now the tricky one is this direction towards zero. It's zero plus I one, where I is the square root of minus one. It's called an imaginary number. It has nothing to do with the real world. It is part of the real world. So this is one example. We have little loops of superconducting material. Current goes this way. It makes the magnetic field pretty up. It's a zero. To the other one, it's a one. We can make them in superposition. We can take atoms, being in their ground state, the lower energy state, or the excited state, it's a zero one. A photon, a particle of light, it's quite a lot of light here. We take this particle one by one. They have the electric field pointing this direction or this direction. It becomes a zero one. So we have many ideas about to build this. And all of them have advantages. This advantage today, and we're going to try, and maybe at some point some of them will be good to become sensors. Those ones will be good for communication, and those qubits will be good for computing.
So, Rob, if I can, so there's a great book that came out recently called Ideal Labs. It's by John Durbin, and it chronicles the creation and life of Bell Labs, which is the place where all this stuff was actually discovered and invented. In the last century that we took advantage of to create the information age. But, when you read and you see two things that come to mind. One is, it's a very small group of people. And they're really passionate about what they're working on, what they've learned. And they're trying to solve some really tough problems. But you also see this other theme that they're constantly fighting against the limits of the technology of the time. So when they were trying to come up, the whole reason that they adopted the vacuum tube from DeForest, from the UK, was because their chairman told them that he wanted to have a cross-continental US phone call, long-distance phone call, in time for the World's Fair. And they went and did that, but they realized that tubes were just not efficient. They very quickly realized that they were inefficient, too big, they ran too hot, all the things that worked against using the future. So they deliberately looked for a solid state equivalent from the vacuum tube amplifier. And they knew that semiconductors were the path. But what they were fighting against, what they believed would make it impossible was they couldn't make the material clean enough, pure enough. To sit there at that time and for them to believe that they can get to impurities of one in a million, one part per million. Back then, seemed impossible. Today, in this lab, we've got that kind of stuff quite routine. And of course, we have to develop that over the last 50 years to build the kind of lithography that we take for granted in our smartphones and computers. But, when we look at it today, when Raymond's talking about the difficulty in making this stuff and isolating it and perfecting it, purifying it, that stuff's going to be seen routine 50 years from now.
It's amazing even to just the word lithography, which is basically about stone, right? It's about silicon, and of course that
idea of working with material in that pure state, but it also, from Bell Labs, spins out into silicon now. It spins out into, you know, both the people from Bell Labs or the ideas from Bell Labs migrate to, near San Francisco.
It's interesting history. I mean, Bell Labs started in New Jersey, right, on the East Coast. And, you know, all those inventions and the fact that the, AT&T was the company that formed Bell Labs to solve their problems. AT&T was a monopoly. It was a government-regulated monopoly, and part of their keeping their monopoly, they kept having to give these concessions to the government. And one of the concessions was quite instrumental, is they gave up their patents for free to U.S. industry. And those patents and some of the researchers, like Schottky, went to the West Coast, to San Jose, Santa Clara. They didn't go to San Francisco, which is kind of interesting. They went to these bomb fields and started their factories and their labs. But the history is really wrong.
So where there was very little before, there's in Silicon Valley. But as you say, you know, kind of this interesting kind of convergence of science and politics and business creates this. Now, tell me about Quantum Valley. It seems like a miracle, and yet, you know, you look at Silicon Valley today, and it's such a presence in our world. It seems incredible that it just kind of came out of nowhere that way. Can something like that be recreated? Could it be recreated here?
What's happening here? First of all, we've got this great university, this community. If you want to see the entrepreneurial spirit, just go back 50, 60 years and just study the history here. And you'll realize that there's always this entrepreneurial spirit to build something special and new here. The university was founded, it was very unorthodox. It was unconventional for the time. They focused on, there's a bigger history there, which you can have time to go into, but the part we remember today is, actuarial science was a very important part of the math. Because we didn't have computers back then. We had people doing the math by hand. And so actuarial science was a big deal because there was a lot of insurance companies and there was a lot of co-op insurance companies because there was this Mennonite community here of farmers and it all sort of fed on itself. And of course the actuarials, the insurance companies wanted more and more people because people didn't scale like computers do. They took time. And so they wanted the students earlier so they could get them ready for working in a corporate environment. And so they came up with this thing called a co-op program for actuaries. And of course that history developed into engineering and science, co-op here. And then of course the university had the presets to put in the first large-scale computer in the country. That's one of the reasons I came here. When you're coming out of high school and you're coming from punch cards, and you see this massive computer, you see all these terminals, it felt like you're going into a science fiction set.
And Mike, more than that, there was a man here, Wes Graham, who allowed undergraduate students to get their hands on this thing. Can you imagine this, this multi-million dollar machine, and undergraduates would get their sticky fingers on this? But in fact, they did. They did, and they created a positive feedback, and they wrote compilers that were designed to help undergraduates use computers. That was Watt 4, and then Watt 5 was the successor, and that gradually took over the world. It took Waterloo's name out into the whole broader community. But if I may, Mike, I'd like to build on a couple of your points about Quantum Valley. You've given some talks that I found very inspiring. One at the AAAS, the American Association for the Advancement of Science in Vancouver, last winter, you talked about the need for education, the need for research, and you ended by saying that, this will change everything. And I'd like to get back to your theme, Ivan, of the bridges, and think of the bridges into the future. The bridges between now and the future. And I think there are actually five bridges. And tell me if you think these are being built in this area. The bridge of research, which leads to new understandings. More will be understood in the future than we understand today. The bridge of education, which leads to the development of people as individuals and also to the diffusion of the new knowledge. Rich of imagination. The possibilities that people think of with that new knowledge. Now this one will surprise you, I guess, the bridge of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurs are people who find and seize opportunities to create value in new ways. Okay. And finally, the bridge of leadership. Somebody has to make sure the effort doesn't get diffused, that it actually leads in the right direction. And you know, I think we've got a lot of those bridges here. Would you agree on that?
Absolutely.
You're one of the peers.
So, troublemakers. So let me get that right. So, research, education, imagination,
entrepreneurship, and leadership.
And leadership. Now, that's a nice list. And Tom, of everyone on the panel, you're the one who's had some experience speaking of leadership, working with political leaders here in the province, and. You know, right now, for example, I'm based in Washington, D.C., and Washington is in the throes of a presidential election, as you may have heard. And one of the themes that comes up is how to jumpstart the economy, how to push, in the context of the U.S., how to maintain competitiveness, and, you know, what can the president do, or what policies can the president follow that will spur innovation, that will spur competitiveness, that will get things moving. And I'm sure this is actually something that comes across, that is on the mind of virtually every political leader today, whether it's the President of the United States, the Premier of a province, or the Mayor of a community such as Waterloo. What can the leadership of a community do to foster this innovation? So from your perspective, Tom, I mean, we've heard a lot about universities, where scientists come in, about education, fostering students. Where does government come in? Is there anything government can do to make things happen?
Sure, build the five bridges. Innovation policy or science policy does not produce innovations. Entrepreneurs do that. And you have to make the distinction between an invention, which may be suggested by the results of good research, and innovation, which means actually having a new product in the market or some new process that displaces what was there previously, so that people like the people in the audience will choose to put their money on that and buy the service or the good that has been produced. So research may lead, if the research is good, to valuable inventions. If the inventions are commercialized properly, with the right business model, with the right marketing, sold to the world, fitted into a value chain, then you may have an innovation. Too many of us, I think, find it too easy to think that good research means innovation. There are all these things in between. And people like Mike, and people in business, particularly in the new ventures that are research-based, the spin-offs from university research, are very much aware of this. They live this. They have to find. They may have an invention, they may have technology, they may work to improve their technology, but until they find a customer, until they make their first sales, they're not going to head to success. They get to success because their sales revenues grow faster than their R&D spending. Without that understanding of the commerce, wonderful ideas may go unused.
But at the same time, you need to have, you have to have the basic research at the beginning.
That's the first bridge.
And I think that, you know, if you're asking about the role for government, I think that's really the place where government has the biggest role, because the really basic research problems are expensive and not profitable.
And they're also long-term.
And they're long.
It's really hard to sell long-term basic research in a boardroom.
Yeah, and so that's something that the companies are not going to shell out money for. But you know, the government isn't required to turn a profit, and you know, hasn't in quite a few years now. But that's actually a good thing. They can be the ones who seed that. And it's a thing that I worry about in the current political climate is and not just in the U.S. but Europe as well. There's far too many places where everybody's saying cut everything, and you're going to sort of cut out that bottom layer, that first step.
It's almost politically expedient to cut out physics, right? Because you know they go, well, nobody understands this stuff anyway, so no one misses it. And yet it has historically the most impact.
And you know, a thing that's striking though, and there is a big audience out there for it. You look at the Higgs boson was mentioned earlier, and that's really captured people's imagination, in large part due to some very hard work publicizing by CERN and institutes like that. And I've always been a little amazed that quantum technology hasn't gotten the same penetration into the public consciousness. But to a large degree, I think that's because the experiments have been very small scale and scattered around the world. That's a thing that I think an institute like this could be really good for, by bringing a lot of people together and getting more of a concerted effort
and critical mass.
And critical mass of people to get that out there.
And there, I should point out that we are incredibly lucky at the institute here of having a partnership between the private sector, the government, both the federal and the province, and incredibly generous, and the University of Waterloo all together. So we have three pieces that kind of working together. We have to be sure that we keep doing this. But up to now, we wouldn't have this building here.
We have 5 minutes left, and in this little bit of time, I want to take you well into the future. Imagine the panel that will be sitting here 50 years from now, celebrating the 50th anniversary of this center. We don't know when large-scale quantum computers will be created or not, but maybe you can give for me a combination of your prediction or your wish, and just I'd love each of you to you know, given that we've talked about how transformative these technologies are, what kind of world we could be living in 50 years from now if the promise of an institution such as this is fulfilled. So Chad, I'm going to start with you. What's it like? And what would it be? 2062.
So I think if you're talking about quantum computing, things like that, I think we're unlikely to be 50 years from now in a world where everyone has a quantum computer and they receive quantum spam from
parallel universes.
So I don't think that's going to happen, but I think that there's a chance that the real impact of quantum computing and things like that will come in solving problems that are fundamentally quantum things, because rather than having to go from a complicated quantum system, write that down in a way that a classical computer can solve it, and then run that on a classical computer, there may be ways to simulate things in quantum computers that are extremely complicated systems, with lots of quantum effects and like strongly correlated collections of large numbers of particles of some sort. And it may be that understanding those problems better through simulation in quantum computers may allow us to do things with energy sources or superconductors or something. But I think it'll be as a base to launching some other technology rather than quantum computing in your phone.
Right.
So I think Chad is very down to earth.
I'm
going to be on the wilder side. So you started with your mother, who was 91. So my grandfather passed away 2 years ago. He was 103. So I look at the calculation of 50. I said, I have plenty of time. So how wild can I be in 50 years? So Chad also mentioned Schrodinger's cat. Now, I'm not sure I want to be alive and dead at the same time. But I'd like to be able to feel what it is to be at more than one place at a given time. What then, if we would be in a supervision, what would we feel? Mm-hmm. I'd like to be quantum teleported. I'll be the first one to get into a ship. And I hope I won't get into go out like a Picasso painting.
Raymond Laflamme.
That's a great image. But you can immediately see the practical
value of that, though. I mean, just imagine all of our scheduling problems that and certainly there's a business opportunity there. So, Mike, what do you think? 50 years from now, what's your vision of this town, this university, this place?
Wow, that's a cool one. What I've found is that when you try to predict this stuff, it's a very unproductive exercise to try to predict it directly. What I find interesting is to look back in history and realize two things. One, the people making those discoveries at the time had no idea what those discoveries would lead to in terms of value creation, jobs, and societal change. They had no idea. And everything they thought of was most cases wrong. It was more exciting, more incredible than anything they could have dreamt of at the time. So with that in mind, then we take to another thing that's happened, and that's things are accelerating. So back then it was very difficult to do things. We wrote letters on paper and we mailed them. and phone calls were non-existent and then they became very expensive. Things are at a point now where they're accelerating as well as becoming more interesting. And so we have those combined differences. One, we have this incredible effect where fundamental discovery causes massive change historically. We have this accelerating technology base that is letting us build things better, with more precision, higher scale. And the third thing, and that's where we have to choose, is that we know how it works. We know the process of discovery and innovation and technology works. And what we're trying to do here, I'm just trying to answer the whole question. So what we're trying to do here in this community is we're trying to learn from history while intercepting these two trends. And we're saying if we can focus the investment, if we can combine all the big, the faculties, the excellent faculties here at the university, engineering, mathematics, science, computer science, quantum information, nanotechnology, putting all this together and focusing it in this facility, allowing the interaction to occur, having the world's largest theoretical physics theory institute in the world just a few kilometers away, bringing all these things to bear, what we're doing is we're learning from history, and we're using strategy to deliberately trying to influence the future. So I think it's going to be really exciting.
What do you think, Tom?
Hard to act to follow that kind of an answer. So let me just express some hopes, two kinds of hopes. One is that in a whole range of areas of human activity, we will have access to very fast, very secure, ubiquitous communications. That's one. And another one for me, a hope that the major trends that are going to cause our problems, growing global population and climate change, that we will find some ways of adapting what we do, managing what we do, responding to what we do, mitigating the unfortunate effects, if there are any, and maybe turning them into very positive effects of these things, using the new technologies whose details we can begin to predict. So I have hopes, I don't have predictions.
Very eloquent, and we appreciate the hope and all of you, that exciting vision for the future. And for those of you in the audience, of course, it took a lot, as you have now heard, many interesting forces and efforts to bring this place together, to bring all of us here at this time to celebrate this beginning. And so now you're at the start of something, and we have yet to see where it will lead us, but certainly it's going to be an exciting journey. At this point, I'd like to thank the panel, and please join me in thanking